I can think of all the times my dad rescued me or bailed me out of some issue or some trouble that I got myself into. And of course, speaking of that, my dad is here, and I just want to honor my dad. My dad really is my hero. I sit there and I think, man, if I could be half the dad, half the husband, half the man of God that my dad is, man, I'd be doing pretty all right in life. And so I love you, Dad. And really just want to celebrate really all the fathers or all the guys in the house that maybe are a father figure in someone's life. And so if we could just take a moment just to appreciate the dads. Entitled Let's Talk, where we've been talking about sort of what prayer is and what prayer is not. And so last week we actually kind of got into a little bit of the how-to of prayer, where we started to unpack what's known in Scripture as the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6. And this is where Jesus kind of teaches us the how-to of prayer. He starts off by saying that this is how to pray. Because he doesn't say what to pray, he says how to pray, because he's teaching us a pattern of prayer. And he starts off by saying, our Father in heaven, our Father in heaven. And the reason he does this is, as we mentioned last week, is because here's the deal, is that your view of God will ultimately shape your approach to God. Your view of God will ultimately shape your approach to God. So if you see him as distant, or you see him as aloof, or you see him as unengaged or uninterested, how many of you know that's going to affect your approach towards him? If even an approach at all, right? And I share that because, listen, I bring this up because I believe this, is few things can shape the view of our Father in heaven than the experiences we have with our Father on earth. And this is where the rub is, I think, for many of us. Because I'm fully aware that for many of you, in fact, stats would say probably maybe most of you, let's be honest, when you hear father or dad, maybe the image that comes to your mind is maybe a little less than heroic. Maybe one who was tended to be a little more than just somewhat absent or distant, or even worse, maybe abusive, maybe emotionally, verbally, even physically. And as a result, it can leave us at times with sort of a distorted view of God, a distorted view of others, even a distorted view of ourselves. And so today, what I want us to do is really kind of dig down on this, and I'm going to do my best to not go too Dr. Phil with you tonight. But we're going to do this and kind of unpack this by revisiting a story in the Bible of a guy who we sort of unpacked a lot of his life in the last series, that Overwhelmed series that we talked on, where we unpacked the life and the story of a guy by the name of David. And I love this story because even if you didn't maybe grow up in church or don't have a lot of church experience, and most of us know in general who David was. Like, we know some highlights of his life. We know that he took down Goliath. We know that he was one amazing dude with the electric harp. I mean, we know some generalities when it comes to him. But what you might not know about David is that David had some daddy issues. David had some daddy issues. In fact, as we're going to discover tonight, much of David's life is really one big case study of a guy wrestling with some deep, deep father wounds. Deep, deep father wounds. And so I want to show you his struggle, but also show you the grace that God gave him to overcome it. And so we're going to dive into this. The first part of the passage we're going to look at is in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 12. As it's here, it says, "Now David was the son of the Ephraimite from Bethlehem of Judah named Jesse. Jesse had 8 sons, and during Saul's reign was already an old man." Now, by the way, a little question here. Do you know what you call your 8th son when you're already an old man? Think about this. What do you call your 8th son when you're already an old man? Yeah, someone said, "Oops, that's exactly it," right? Because like you're thinking about like you're about ready to retire, right? I mean, you're ready to retire, you're ready to travel the world, and then, honey, surprise, right? You got to put all that on hold. Because in the Bible, interesting enough, actually, the number 7 actually signifies completion. Yeah, here we have David, number 8, showing up and putting on hold all of Jesse's plans to sort of remodel the kids' former bedroom into a man cave. He's got to, you know, put on hold the tickets to the Caribbean cruise. And all this happens, all this is put on hold as David shows up and talks about throwing a wrench into your long-term retirement plans. And so anyway, the story kind of continues on. Verse 13 says, Jesse's three oldest sons had followed Saul to war. And then verse 15 says, but David kept going back and forth from Saul. Back and forth from Saul. Now, that's going to become a very significant theme as we're going to discover as we work through some of these passages tonight. As we see David going back and forth to tend his father's flock in Bethlehem. So here he goes, back and forth from Saul to Jesse, from the palace to the pasture, from his place of recognition and success to this place where he's in an environment where they barely seem to notice he even exists. And he does this all because there's something that's sort of missing. There's something that's missing in his life. This boy who even the king recognizes, talented and anointed. I mean, he's gigging every Saturday night to packed out houses and crowds. People that are like, David, you're amazing. David, you're incredible. And yet, even though the king saw him, the king noticed him, other people noticed him, other people recognized his greatness, recognized his giftedness. The one person that he wanted to notice the most never seemed to pay much attention to him at all. And so he lives his whole life, much of his life, going back and forth and trying to prove something to somebody. In fact, that's sort of the title of kind of tonight's message is this really simply the back and forth to Bethlehem. The back and forth to Bethlehem. I want us to pray tonight, and then we're going to really dig into this. But Father God, I just pray tonight that you would use your word, God, just to show us something. Show something about our hearts. Show something about our relationship with not just our Heavenly Father, but not just with our earthly Father, but most importantly with our Heavenly Father, with you, God. I pray that you would use your word to convict in some cases, challenge us. I pray you would use your word, God, to restore, bring some healing into some people's hearts and lives tonight. And I pray most importantly, God, that as we work through this message, as we hear from your word, I pray that you would just remind us that truly, when we're in a relationship with you, God, when you look at us, you see sons and daughters and children of you, God. Beautiful, precious, loved, chosen, forgiven. And God, we thank you so much for that. And so, Lord, we commit this time to you in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, just to kind of give that passage that we just shared a little bit of context, you got to understand, again, kind of to go back a few chapters earlier, 1 Samuel 13, when Samuel, the prophet Samuel, he gets word from God that there's going to be a change at the top of the organization of Israel. He's making some changes, he's cleaning house, there's going to be a new king, and that king is no longer Saul. That Saul's dynasty is coming to an end, kind of like the warrior's dynasty came to an end a couple nights ago. Any Raptors fans in the house? There's like no Raptors fans. Anyone anyone that was for any other team besides the Warriors in the house, right? Yeah, they're excited that this dynasty finally came to an end. But that's kind of what's going on there. And so he tells this prophet Samuel, he's like, I'm going to use you to kind of lead up the charge of making some changes. I'll use you to kind of lead up the headhunting crew, to search the LinkedIn profiles, to find us the brand new kind of king of Israel. And it's interesting, God had sort of one requirement for this. And he kind of instills in his Samuel and says, I'm looking for a man. Here's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for a man after my own heart. And not after his own interests, not after his own wants, his own desires, but a man who's after my own heart. And so he sends Samuel out there, and then he gives Samuel a little bit of direction in this too. This wasn't just like, all right, well, good luck to you, Samuel. Pat on the back, find someone, man, after my own heart, and good luck to you. He actually gives us some pretty specific instructions in 1 Samuel chapter 16:1, as he says, I'm sending you to Jesse of Bethlehem because I've selected a king from his sons. Now, literally in Hebrew, that phrase that selected in the original kind of Hebrew language, it's actually more phrased the better, I have seen a king among his sons. I've seen a king among his sons. So God sends Samuel to Jesse's house and tells Jesse, listen, there's a king among your kids. And so Jesse calls for his seven sons together, and he starts with the oldest because, of course, in his mind, he hears that God's looking for a man after his own heart. So why wouldn't you start with the guys who, for all intents and purposes, were men? Because again, remember, David's just a boy. And he came on later onto the scene. All the other brothers of his, these are grown adults. These are grown men. They've got wives, they've got kids, they've got children, they've got families of their own. And so Jesse, he hears a man after God's own heart, so he just starts bringing from the oldest to the youngest his seven sons in front of Samuel. And so he starts with Elias, starts with the oldest one, and Samuel looks at him and is like, man, I'm not feeling it. I'm not hearing it from the Lord. This isn't the one. And then he moves on to the next son, and then the next son. And he gets through all seven sons. So at the end, Samuel's like, did I miss something? I'm pretty sure God led me here, Jesse, to your house. Like, is this all your sons? Because I'm not seeing the king that God called me to come and anoint here in this room of seven sons. Are you sure that this is all of your sons? And you just imagine Jesse in that moment just kind of thinking about it and kind of like, this isn't all my sons exactly. I mean, he did ask for a man after God's own heart, but these are all men. But I do this boy, but surely he couldn't be who you're looking for. Because Jesse, he struggled to see that there could be any type of royalty. He struggled to see that there could be a king in this boy, in David. And yet Samuel goes on to ask him, bring David here. And about the moment that David shows up on the scene, Samuel's like, man, he's the one. And he anoints him. He sees this king in David that, ironically enough, Jesse failed to see. And listen, I share this because I wonder how many times as parents, and especially as dads, have we failed to see the royalty in our kids, the potential in our kids, the king inside the boy, the queen inside the girl. And not just to see it, but to actually say it. To actually say it. I like how Jim Valvano puts it. He says, my father gave me the greatest gift anyone can give another person. He believed in me. I love that. And listen, I share this because that, ultimately, when you get down to the responsibility of a father, that is our number one responsibility. A father's calling, I put it in my notes this way, a father's calling is to see the king and call the king out of the kid. It's to see the king and call the king out of the kid, to see the potential and to speak to see the future, not just see, but to say what you see. And listen, I think we live in a world of way too many silent fathers and blind fathers who unfortunately don't see or don't recognize or don't speak into the potential and the royalty and the wonder and the worth and the value of their kids. And as a result, we get children who grow up sometimes not knowing the significance that they have, not understanding the royalty that's inside them, the purpose that's inside of them, the value that's inside of them, the significance that's inside of them. And as a result, they settle for something so much less than that, wondering if they're good enough, if there's anything of value, anything of worth in them, all because somebody didn't see the king inside the kid. Some of the pushback. Actually, when I was kind of reading this, it's like at first I was like, maybe I can kind of see a little bit why Jesse kind of struggled to see the king inside his boy. Because when I was first kind of reading this passage, I always kind of understood it, or always kind of thought of it in the light of that that the reason that Jesse struggled to really see the potential, see the value, see the significance in his son was because on the surface, there wasn't anything extraordinary about his son, David. He's just a classic shepherd boy in the field. And yet the reality is that that's actually not true. David was actually exceptionally gifted. He was a savant, if you will. David was a combo of sort of Davy Crockett and Mozart. I don't know if you noticed, but Mozart actually wrote like his first symphony when he was four. And that was kind of like David. In fact, it's interesting, when we were in Nashville, we were taking a tour of our recording, music recording studios, and so we're driving around in this van, and the tour guide, she goes, has anyone ever written a song? Of course, it's like my boy throws his hand up. He's like, yes, I've written like three of them, right? And everyone applauds. Here's this child prodigy, right? The next, next Garth Brooks or Lionel Richie ready to come about. But that was like David. I mean, David was exceptionally gifted. And listen, all this, he'd actually already built a name for himself well before he actually went and fought Goliath. So often we think that it was only after Goliath all of a sudden people saw the exceptional giftedness in David. But check this out. 1 Samuel 16, verses 17 through 18. This is before he's become a national hero. It says, then Saul commanded his servants, find me someone who plays well and bring it to me. He's talking about, he's looking for a musician. I don't necessarily know why, outside of, maybe to uphold the Saturday night, open mic nights. We don't know exactly why. but he's looking for a musician. And certainly David, when David would play, as we're getting, you should really read the story and discover that when he would lead people in worship, that there was something incredibly healing. There was something incredibly encouraging for Saul out of that. But anyway, he asked for someone who plays well to bring him to me. And one of the servants answered, I have seen a son of Jesse of Bethlehem who knows how to play the lyre. He's a brave man and a warrior. He speaks well. Now notice, upon Saul's request for a band for the open mic nights, we read of someone who's like, I know the guy you need. He's amazing. He's incredible. Like I've heard of, me and my buddies, we go down and listen to him all the time. Like, he can play the harp like Buddy Guy. He can sing like Lionel Richie. And yet, while others could see it, notice the one person who couldn't, Jesse. And listen, I share this because, and in fact, if I can kind of challenge us, those of us who are parents, husbands, wives, even grandparents, listen, don't ever let somebody outside your house have a better understanding of the gifts inside your house than you do. Don't ever let somebody outside your house have a better understanding of the gifts inside your house than you do. Because here's the danger in that. When we do, is that, listen, people will always gravitate to the place where their gifts are celebrated. They'll always gravitate to the place where their gifts are celebrated. So if somebody outside your house sees and celebrates the gift inside your house better than you do, then don't be surprised if the people in your house start to gravitate out of your house. Right? And leaving so many of us to sort of wonder, man, why do the kids not want to be in the house anymore? Why don't they want to hang out with us? Why don't they want to spend time around us anymore? Well, what could it be? Because someone else learned to celebrate and see the gifts outside of the house better and more clearly than you ever saw them inside the house. And in fact, I wonder if it's, for some of us, if we get really honest and get really real about this, I wonder why your husband always spends so much time in the office. Could it be because that's the place where his gifts are celebrated the most? And listen, I'm not saying that's right, but I'm saying it's a reality, is that we gravitate to the place where our gifts are celebrated the most. Or you wonder why your wife is always living on social media all the time, rather than wanting to be around you or hang out with you. And look, I get the pushback going, you don't understand. You don't understand my wife. And she's always nagging me on this. Or she always talks too much. Well, could it be the reason she talks so much is because you say so little? Right? And again, this challenge, I bring this up and I share this is because, man, we got to learn to be people. We learn to celebrate the gifts of those in our house, those around us. May the people who celebrate the gifts the most in the lives of our kids, and in the lives of our spouse, the lives of our family and loved ones, may they be the ones who celebrate the most, be us, not some stranger, not some random person who doesn't even know them at all. Because again, people will always gravitate to the place where their gifts are celebrated the most. And look, I share this, and again, this is why this matters, is that when we don't see the king within the kid, we don't recognize that, and don't celebrate the gifts that they have, the talent they have, the ability they have, the potential they have, and not just see it, but actually say it. What happens when prodigies go unseen, when daughters go unseen by their fathers, when they don't hear the words, you're significant, you're royalty, you're beautiful, you've got purpose, that I believe in you, God's got his hand on you. Well, listen, the problem is it can reduce a couple of certain side effects that I just want to touch on real quickly. The first one is it can produce the side effect of creating strivers. It's a situation in life, it's kind of this drive in life where we're desperately working to prove something to somebody because it never heard it's enough or you're enough. They never heard the words of a good father who said, you're my beloved son in whom I am well pleased, before they ever did anything, before they ever accomplished anything, before they ever achieved anything. And so what happens, they feel like they have to perform their way for affirmation. And that's actually what David was trying to do. I mean, that was David's story. David could perform in the pasture. He could perform in the palace. He could kill lions and tigers and bears, oh my. And he could play a song. And he could do whatever he needed to do to make you like him, even love him. He lived his life trying to strive for affirmation. In fact, one of the ways we can know this was the case for David is in chapter 17 when he takes on Goliath. Remember when he took on Goliath? Now remember, he's just a kid at this point. He shows up on the scene at Saul's doorstep and says, hey, I see that giant. No one's wanting to take him on, but hey, I'll take on the fight. Just give me a chance. Listen, I've got some experience in this. I've been watching my dad's flocks. I've been watching the sheep. And when a lion came, hey, I did a run from the fight. I actually went towards it. I took down the lion. Killed the lion. And when a bear came on the scene, I chased after the bear and chased him away. And again, you're just kind of looking at this, and you can't but think when you just kind of read of this and read of, you know, David's kind of pursuit of the fight, and you sit there and you think, man, what kind of kid? What kind of kid fights giants? What kind of kid fights lions? What kind of kid fights tigers? Well, in fact, I think of my boy. While he can talk a good game, he's a tough kid, and you get bees around him, it's amazing how, like, Superman will turn into Clark Kent instantly, right? So what kind of kid chases after a lion and runs after a bear? I'll tell you what kind of kid. The kind of kid that's desperate to get his father's attention and affection. The kind of kid who's desperate to get his father's attention and affection. Hey, Dad. Lions after sheep, but don't worry, I got this. Hey, Dad, there's a bear, but don't worry, I chased him off. Did you see that? Did you hear about that? Hey, Dad, did you hear that I slayed Goliath, right? Desperate to hear this affirmation that you're good enough. And so David does what so many of us do. We fall in this trap of just striving, thinking it's going to come because you've earned enough, or you've done enough, or you killed a lion, or you killed a bear, or you sang a good song, you got a promotion, you bought a new house, only to find it's never enough, and so you keep running back and forth to Bethlehem. So some of us, when we're caught in the cycle, we end up being strivers. For some of us, we're on the other end, though. We end up being strollers. This is the other side effect, is that if you're not a striver, sometimes you'll be a stroller. In fact, actually, I'd say this, though. Sometimes the same person can actually be a striver in one season and a stroller in the next. Because if you strive long enough, what you realize is that it's never enough. It's exhausting to be a striver. You're constantly feeling like your value, your worth is based on your performance, right? Because for me to get my affirmation from my performance means the only way I keep that affirmation is I got to keep the performance up. So I got to keep singing the song. I got to keep, you know, doing the dance. I got to keep achieving this and getting that and buying that. And I got to keep on striving. And how many know that's an exhausting way to live when you feel like your value, your worth is simply based on your performance. And at some point, inevitably, every striver ultimately gives up and becomes a stroller. They get to the place where it's like, man, why even try? Why does it even matter? In fact, in David's life, we see this. Later on in David's life, 2 Samuel 11, David's achieved a lot. He's been a king for a while. He's accomplished a lot. He's got all the trophies on the wall. People are praising his name, cheering him on. And yet here's David kind of gotten to a place where he's just like, man, why bother? Yeah, everyone else thinks I'm great. Everyone else has affirmed me, except for the one person I so desperately want to hear those words of, well done, good and faithful son. Well done, good job, from my own dad. And so he gets to this place where it's like, man, why even bother? Why try? Why do I do this? And we see this in 2 Samuel 11, 2, kind of the pinnacle of this exhaustion, this place of just settling into a life of strolling. It says, one evening, David got up from his bed and walked around on the roof of the palace. In fact, actually before that, it says that during the springtime when most kings go off to war. And yet here's David, not going off to war, not going off to fight the battle he should be fighting. What's David doing? He's given up. He's achieved all this stuff, but he's fallen in this pattern of strolling. Notice it says one evening. In other words, David knows he's not waking up. He's not waking up in the morning. He's not waking up like ready, you know, grabbing his cup of coffee. It says he doesn't wake up until the evening time. Now think about this. What are you doing, David? What were you doing the night before, David, that would lead you to the place where you're not getting up anymore until the evening time of the next day? And again, you see this guy with no motivation, no striving whatsoever, you know, no passion at all for the life that he's living. And here he is, he's just kind of strolling around. And look, I share this because something you've got to understand about the voice of a father. The voice of a father really has a twofold purpose. The first is you've got to call the king out of the kid. But listen to me, a father calls the king out of the kid, but a father also calls the kid out of the king. Father also calls the kid out of the king, because just like in every kid, there's a king. I'm telling you, in every king, there's a kid. If you doubt this, just ask any lady who's married to a man. They will acknowledge and give an amen that there is a kid in every single king, every single guy. And there's a boy in there. There's a kid in there. And listen, I highlight this because that kid, though, if we're not careful, can have the capacity to sabotage the king. The kid, if it's not subdued, and the thing that makes the king subdue the kid, the thing that makes a man put the boy down and step into adulthood and step into responsibility, I'm telling you, it was a voice of a father who says, "You're better than this. You're better than this. I see a king in you. I see potential in you. I see a future in you. I see value in you. I see worth in you."
Amen.
Listen, that's what pulls the kid out of it. It calls the kid out of the king to allow the king to be revealed from the kid. And it takes a good father, because listen, a good father's not going to let you sleep all day. A good father's going to be like, "David, what do you think you're doing? You know, this is the time you're supposed to be out to war. You've got a job to get to. You've got a job to take care of. What are you doing sleeping in until the evening time?" A good father won't just sit there and, "David, you're meant for more than this. God created you for more than this. You need to get up out of this bed. You need to take care of your responsibility." A good father will do that. And listen, man, I think now more than ever, when we look at the generation and culture we live in, we need some fathers to have the courage to call the kid out of the king just as much as we call the king and see the king out of the kid and see the potential there. You know, my dad, my dad was great about this. You know, my dad was always good at speaking and seeing the king and the kid, but he was also great at calling the kid out of the king. In fact, there's tons of times where my dad would, you know, it really encouraged me and challenged me, especially when I would just do something that was just incredibly adolescent or make some just dumb decision or poor decision. You know, my dad was always really quick. He's, you know, he'd remind me of the potential, remind me of my future, but he was also really quick to call the kid out, you know, and like, you know, "You're better than this. God's called you for more than this." And one time I was trying to think of so many stories of this, but I remember my dad. Oftentimes when it would come to Sunday mornings, I remember when I was a kid, and Sunday mornings, my dad, he was always really intent on making sure we got to church, and of course my dad liked to get us to church on time. The problem is that as a kid, church was not where I wanted to go. I wanted to sleep in on Sunday morning, and so I remember my dad, he'd be like, "Come on, you know, we got to get to church," and the whole time I'm dragging my feet, like, "I don't want to go to church, Dad, don't make me go to church." And I remember one Sunday morning in particular, we're in the garage, we're getting in the car, parked in the garage, and so we get in there, and we're in a rush, we're in a hurry, and so I leave the car door open, and I'm kind of turning to kind of put the seatbelt on, and my dad starts to pull out. And then the car door hits the side of the garage door, just kind of buckles back, you know, and I can just see my dad. But my dad was an incredibly patient man, because like I knew there were some things he wanted to say in that moment that he had the strength to not say in that moment. But I remember my dad kind of looking at it like the door was just, I I mean, it was shot. It was a mess. It was in, you know, just bad condition. And in a weird way, I'm kind of looking at this like, well, yeah, at least I'll have to go to church, right? But not my dad. My dad's like, my dad, a lot of guys would have just given up at that point. Like, well, I guess it's just not meant to be to go to church today. You know, or, you know, it's a, you know, this is a mess. You know, let's stay home, take care of this. But my dad was like, no, we're going to church. Because like we're gonna be at church, and so there we are. And he like shut somehow. He got the door kind of back connected, and so we're driving to church, just like barely hanging on. And we get there, and I share that with you because again, my dad, it would have been easy for him to just kind of buy into it, and kind of surrender to the whinings of his kid. And I don't want to go to church, Dad. Just been like, okay. But not my dad. My dad, you know, in doing that, what he was doing was he was actually kind of calling the kid out of the game. He was reminding him that there's some things that are worth fighting for. There's some things that are worth struggling for. There's some things that are worth pushing through for. That church matters. That faith matters. That your relationship with Christ matters. You know, my dad, again, was an expert at not just seeing the king and the kid, but calling out the kid out of the king. And listen, again, this is so vital. It's so important for us. And I think, Dad, sometimes I don't think we always realize just how important your voice is, but it's essential. It's so vital. Because in David's life, and we really see why it matters so much that we do this, because David, again, listen, he never had this voice in his life. He never had this voice in his life. And because of that, he got stuck in this cycle that so many of us can find ourselves stuck in. And we see this cycle kind of play out. 1 Samuel 16:21 says, when David came to Saul and entered his service, Saul admired him greatly and became his armor bearer. That word there, that phrase, admired him, is actually really Saul loved him. He loved him dearly. He was basically David's number one fan. It's like, you know, every time Saul, or every time David, you know, initially showed up around Saul, I was like, David, you're amazing. David, I love you, man. David, I appreciate you. In fact, at one point, David became so invaluable to Saul, he actually, you know, picks up the phone, calls Jesse. He's like, listen, man, you've got to let me keep David on staff here. Let me keep David around all summer, not just all summer, but let him live here because he's invaluable to me and to the organization here and to government. And so, and yet, even with that, so here you got, think about this, you've got the king of Israel, who he was constantly like, David, you're amazing, you're awesome, you're incredible, I can't live without you, I can't do this job without you. And yet, even with that, again, kind of going back to that verse that we opened up with, we find David constantly running back and forth from Bethlehem. Running back and forth from David, and all the people are like, David, you are amazing, from this place where, you know, they're playing all of David's hits, or they're like, they're soaring through the Billboard Top 100. I mean, everyone's tweeting about David, he's amazing. Going from Saul's palace, where he's got all this affirmation, all this love, to going back home to Bethlehem, to a dad who doesn't seem to notice anything. Any real value, any real worth, any real significance in the life of his son. And yet we see him going back and forth. And you sit there and you wonder why. Why the back and forth? And really the only answer you can come up with was this desperation to get his father's attention and approval. This constant going back and forth like, Dad, did you hear what I just did? Dad, did you hear that I killed that bear? Dad, did you hear that I took down Goliath? Dad, did you hear that I'm headlining on the Saturday night gigs in Saul's palace? Back and forth. This cycle where here's David, I'm successful, but it's not enough. I've arrived, but I'm still running back home because, listen, there's some fulfillment that a promotion can't provide. There's some significance that a boss can't give you or a bigger house can provide for you. See, there's something inside every one of us that needs to hear the words of a father. The words of a father that say, this is my beloved son, this is my beloved daughter, whom I'm well pleased. Because until we get that, until we really hear that, I'm telling you, you'll be running back and forth to Bethlehem. Striving, eventually strolling, successful but not satisfied, accomplished but never feeling fully affirmed. It's why you see grown men and women, families of their own, grandchildren even, businesses built, money and names made, still running back and forth, desperate for somebody to tell me it's enough, to tell me I'm enough. And it's a cycle so many of us find our lives lived in, which of course leads to the question as we kind of start to wrap this up, which is, well, how do you break the cycle, right? You know, how do you break the cycle when you're stuck in that? You know, I mean, because again, and certainly that was what it was for David. I mean, the interesting thing with David is actually there's nowhere in Scripture do we actually ever read of him like reconciling the relationship with his dad. Like, there's never this point where, you know, Jesse's like, man, David, I'm really sorry. I should have seen the king. I should have seen the potential. I should have called it out more. Or I should have, you know, really been there to really be a father in your life, not just a friend, you know, and then really, you know, call the kid out of you. We never see any of that. We never see any of that. This relationship never fully, you know, seems to ever get resolved through Scripture. And yet, and of course, it leads to this question, well, what do you do with that? How do you break the cycle if there's some words you need to hear from a father, and yet the father isn't really there and around to really speak those? How do you deal with that? And the only answer I can actually find some of the last words of David. And we see in 2 Samuel 23, verse 1, it says, these are the last words of David. The declaration of David, son of Jesse, the one anointed by the God of Jacob. Son of Jesse, the one anointed by the God of Jacob. I love that first part. It says, David, son of Jesse. Notice he doesn't dishonor his dad. He doesn't, you know, he doesn't take this opportunity to really complain and share of, oh, kind of woe is me and how bad my dad was. And you know, he doesn't disown his dad. He's like, this is who I am. This is a part of my life. This is part of my mystery or a part of my experience. And in fact, he actually honors in many ways his dad. And listen, I think the only way you can do that is through the choice of forgiveness. You want to break the cycle. You want to start to break from going back and forth to Bethlehem. And listen, I'm telling you, forgiveness, making that choice to forgive, man, is so vital. But not just that. The key thing is in those words, anointed by the God of Jacob. Anointed by the God of Jacob. See, listen, I'm convinced the only answer for sons of Jesse and daughters of Jesse is the God of Jacob. It's the God of Jacob. See, I don't think it was by accident. Like David could have used a lot of names for God. We went through those last week. You know, he could have used Yahweh. He could have used, you know, my fortress or my rock. Or he could have gone through a litany of names. But to choose, hey, the God of Jacob, anointed me. Listen, I don't think that was by accident. Because David shared a very similar story and experience to Jacob. You remember Jacob? You know, Jacob, of course, he was one of two twin boys, Jacob and Esau. And before they were even born, God spoke to their mom and said, listen, inside your womb are two nations. In other words, two kings. And she hears this, and yet when they're born, at that time, of course, in the Bible, the dad actually had naming rights. You know, so it wasn't the mom who gave the name. It wasn't even the joint name. It was the dad who would name the kids. And so when the kids come out, when Jacob and Esau came out, here you got a father. He's like, I'm just not seeing it. I'm not seeing the king. And so he names Esau Harry, because apparently it was Harry, and apparently this dad really lacked on creativity. Names, and then Jacob, he called him heel grabber, because when Esau was coming out, Jacob's hand was holding on to the heel of Esau. But even more than that, heel grabber isn't, of course, the greatest name you want either. But what makes it even worse is that name actually has even more meanings than that. The other meanings of that is supplanter or saboteur or deceiver or con artist. That was what Jacob meant. Can you imagine having that for a name? They're like, that's your name? And so not surprisingly, Jacob lived up, or rather lived down to the label that his father gave him. Because listen, parents, I'm telling you, whether you know it or not, your children are listening. They will live up to or live down to the level of your expectations that you have for them. So if your expectations are incredibly low, like, man, the kids are always going to be a failure, always going to be a disappointment, don't be surprised if they live up to that. You know, or vice versa as well, though. If you've got great expectations for them, you see the king and you call the king out of the kid, I'm telling you, they will rise to that expectation as well. And so here's Jacob. He says that, here he's wrestling with his name. That's his identity. And so he actually go on to be one of the great deceivers, great supplanters, great saboteurs in history. All the way until towards the end of his life when God intervenes. And he starts to actually, there's a scene where he starts to really wrestle with Jacob. He literally wrestles with him. And in the process of it, he asks Jacob, he says, Jacob, what's your name? And Jacob goes, well, my name is Jacob. I'm a liar. I'm a cheater. I'm a failure. A disappointment. Right? Like he's going through the whole list. Everything he heard, labels he heard. And you know what's interesting in this moment, the end of Genesis, God shows up and he, in wrestling with him, he says, no. I know that's what others have called you. That's what others have labeled you. But that's not who I see. That's not who I say you are. Who I say you are, your name is going to be Israel. You know what Israel means? Prince. Prince. Isn't it interesting that the name that God would speak over Jacob was interesting enough, the very name that he gave to his mom literally all that time, all those years earlier. And I love it too, because really it's an incredible picture of really what happens when you and I give our lives to Christ. When you and I step into this relationship with God, where we're willing to have the courage to wrestle through our fears and wrestle with our doubts and just come to God and just surrender to God. Well, what does he do? The Bible says he gives us a new identity. We will become a new creation in him. It speaks in other places in the Bible. He becomes a father to the fatherless. That when we step into that decision, to step into a relationship with him, it says the Bible says that he gives us a spirit that's not one of fear, but cries out, Abba, Father, Daddy. A good father. A great father. And listen, I share that with you because this is key. Because listen, I think you'll always struggle to see God for who he is until you have an encounter with the God who sees you for who you are. Until you encounter this God who says, no, when I see you, Jacob, when I see you, son of Jesse, when I see you, daughter of Jesse, when I see you, I don't see a failure, I don't see a disappointment, I see a king, I see a prince, I see royalty, I see an overcomer, I see purpose. And listen, that's where it has to start. You want to break this cycle of going back and forth, constantly striving and feeling like it's never enough. Listen, there are some words that have to be spoken by a father. But more than the words of a father on earth that we need to hear, man, you and I, we desperately needed to hear the words of a father in heaven who says, I love you, not because of what you do, not because of what you achieve, but just simply who you are in me. As a son, as a daughter, as a child of God. That's where it starts. That's where it starts. I want to pray for you tonight. I especially want to pray for some of you who, again, maybe